Hi friends, in this tutorial we'll see how to implement session management using Spring Boot. Also we'll be using Spring Session JDBC for storing sessions in MySQL database. For this I'll be taking reference of my website javainews.com. So go to Spring Boot section. The example that we are going to see today is Spring Boot Session Management Hello World example. I'll be sharing this URL along with the YouTube video. So let us first have a look at what is session management and why do we need it. So we all know that HTTP is a stateless protocol. Now what do we mean by a stateless protocol? Now for example, we are getting this page by hitting the URL spring boot session. Now when we hit this URL, it goes to the server and the server returns us this page. Now suppose if I refresh this page, then again a new request will go. But the server on its own, it will not know that this is a returning user, since we are again asking for a second page. In case of HTTP, each request is a new request for the server. But sometimes we may need to keep track of the client's activity across multiple requests. This helps the server serve the client much better. For example, if a client is a returning user to a shopping website, then the shopping website server can show the client much more relevant results if he knows about his previous search history, and this can be done using session management. So session management, it is a mechanism used by the web container to store session information for a particular user. Session management, it can be achieved in one of the following ways: cookies, hidden form field, URL rewriting, and HTTP session. In this example, we'll be making use of HTTP session to achieve session management. Also, we'll be using the Spring Session module. For the Spring Session, it consists of the following submodules: Spring Session Core, Spring Session Data Redis, Spring Session JDBC, and Spring Session Hazelcast. So in this post, we'll be using Spring Session JDBC to store the Spring Session information. By default, Apache Tomcat stores HTTP session objects in memory. So let us see how the default HTTP session works, and then we'll see how the Spring JDBC session it will work. Suppose we have a client one which is requesting for some data from a Tomcat server. So this client one, it will be visiting this Tomcat server for the first time. Since it is visiting for the first time, therefore new session it will be created in the Tomcat memory, and this HTTP session will then be attached to the response that is sent to the client one. Now client one, when it will again suppose request for some new data a second time, it will be having this session attached to the request itself. So then the Tomcat server will know, yes, that this is a returning user. Similarly, now if a client two visits it for the first time, for it also a new session will be created in the Tomcat memory itself, and it will be attached to the response, so that the next time client two, it will again be sending this HTTP session information to the Tomcat server to tell it that yes, I am a returning user. Using Spring Session JDBC, we'll be storing all the session information in a data store. In this example, we'll be using MySQL as the data store. So all the session information that we get from the client or for a particular client, it will be stored in the MySQL database. We'll see it how it is done. So in order to achieve writing the session information to the MySQL database, we don't have to write any custom code. Spring Boot provides us this functionality out of the box when we specify this property in the configuration. Spring Session store type is equal to JDBC. So when we specify this, Spring knows that yes, it will have to use JDBC to store the messages or the session information in some data store. Spring Session replaces the HTTP session implementation by its own custom implementation. To perform this task, Spring Session creates a session repository filter bean named as Spring Session repository filter. So all this is done behind the scene by Spring Boot, and we don't have to worry at all about it. So let us begin with the implementation part. This will be the Maven project that we are going to implement. So go to Eclipse and create a new Maven project. Create a simple project. Group ID will give it as com.javainews. Artifact ID I'll just give it as boot session. Next, let us add the required dependencies. So the dependencies that we are going to use are, since we are going to use a controller to expose an API, so we'll be requiring this Spring Boot starter web. Then since we have to store it in MySQL database, the session information, therefore we'll be requiring the starter JDBC dependency. Also for the UI, we are going to use Thymeleaf. So Spring Boot starter Thymeleaf dependency is going to be needed. For the session management, with Spring, we are going to need these both dependencies. Spring Session Core and Spring Session JDBC. Also, since we are using MySQL as a data store to store the session information, therefore we'll be adding this MySQL dependency. So let us add these dependencies. Next, we'll be creating the required classes. So the first class that we'll be creating will be the Spring Boot Bootstrap class to start the Spring Boot application. So go to source main Java, new class. Package will give it as com.java in use. Copy the content of this class. Next, let us create a controller class which has three APIs here. So one API, it is for writing information to the session. The other API is for destroying the session, and the third API, it is for displaying the information that is there in the session. So let us first have a look at the persist message API. So this is a post mapping. So here we have two parameters. One is a string message and the other is the HTTP servlet request. So this is the message that we have to store in the session object that we have. So in this persist message, what we do is, from the HTTP servlet request we get a session object, and in the session object we first check if there is an array list of string already there. If an array list of string is there in this session object, then we add the existing message to that array list. If the array list, it is not there, that is if this message is equal to null, then we create a new array list, and then to that array list we add the message that we want to store in the session. So if the user, he is a first time user, then the first time this array list, it will be null, and then we'll create this array list and store the message. So this is what we are doing. In the HTTP session we create a array list named as my session messages, and in this array list we are going to store the messages that we want for this particular HTTP session. So the first time user, this array list, it will be null. So since it is null, we'll be creating it only the first time, and then the next time we'll be just be adding the messages to the existing array list. Once we have added the message to the array list, we redirect it to the process method where we are just displaying the messages that are there in the array list. Finally, for the third API, destroy session, we are just destroying the HTTP session object that we have by calling the invalidate method. So let us create this controller class. Create a new class. The package will be com.javainuse.controller. Copy the contents. Next, we'll be creating the configuration file. So here we have specified the MySQL database details. Also, we have specified Spring Session Store type as JDBC. So let us create this application.properties file. Copy the contents. Next, we'll be creating index.html. So for this we are using Thymeleaf. So this, it can be divided into three sections. The first section, it is for getting the messages that is to be stored in the session. The second one is to display the session information, and finally we'll be having a destroy method which will destroy the session. So let us create this index.html. So go to Eclipse, source main resources, create a new folder, templates. Inside this we'll be creating a new file, index.html. Let us copy the contents. So we are done with the code changes. Now let us start the application. One thing that you must have noticed is that nowhere we are trying to persist the session information in the database. This is done behind the scenes by Spring Boot itself, since we have specified this property. So let us see how it works. So start the application. Go to the MySQL command line and Here use the database spring session. Show tables. So these are the two tables that have been created by Spring JDBC itself. One is the spring session and the other is the spring session attributes. Next, go to localhost 8080. So here this is the UI. Suppose I have to store this message 1. So here we have created a session and we have in that session we have stored the message 1. So let us see in the DB how it is. Spring JDBC session, it makes use of these two tables to store the session information. In spring session we have the session information, and in the spring session attributes we have all the messages that are related to this spring session that just got created. So let us see both these tables. Select star from spring session. So currently we have a single session here in this table. Next, let us see what is there in the other table. So in the other table we'll be having the message that is attached to the session that got created. So here the message that we just created now, it is stored in this table. Suppose if I create message 2 and I do save message. Now again if I go to the session attributes table, here it will be having two messages now, message 1 and message 2. So the related messages that are there for this session, it is getting stored in the spring session attributes. Now let us go to another browser and here again visit that page. And now suppose here I type some other message, maybe hello 1, save message. Now since we are using another client, therefore a new session object will have got created, and this hello 1, it would have got attached to that session object. So let us check the first table, spring session. So here we can see that now there are two session objects, and if we'll go in the attributes table, and here we can see that this hello 1 message, it is attached to another session object, whereas message 1 and message 2, they are attached to other session objects. So our example, it is working properly. I hope you have understood this tutorial. The source code for this, it can be downloaded from here. Thank you.